You are now tuned in to Vibin' in the D with Lili, the podcast dedicated to the creatives of Detroit. Now let's get into this vibe session.
What's up, Jay's Beers?
Hey.
Hey. How you doing tonight?
Good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm hanging. You know what? I'm not going to say that. I learned to not say I'm hanging in there because that means your life is dull and you're just hanging in there. So I'm great.
That's right.
I am great. My glasses are fogging up, but I'm great.
Them things is great.
Thank you.
I just want to compliment you on them glasses. They are so nice on you.
Thank you.
It took me a minute
to get used to them because they're bigger than I normally would wear. Mm-hmm. But you know, sometimes you got to switch it up a little bit.
Yeah, they fit you very nicely.
So welcome to Vibin' in the D with Lili in Live and in Living Color.
Yeah, thank you.
We did the episode over the phone before, but I just was not satisfied with that. Mm-hmm. You know, this COVID-19 has made everything crazy. Mm-hmm. And, you know, prior to doing that, I would either meet at somebody's house. Mm-hmm. Or they would come to my house, or you know, we would meet at a neutral location or whatever, and we'd have mics on and everything, and mm-hmm. you know, that was great because it was cool to sit with the person and talk. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, when this happened, I kind of stopped doing it because mm-hmm. I was like, well, what am I supposed to do now? I didn't want to do Instagram because I kept getting irritated at the feedback issue on there. Let me find something. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I found StreamYard.
This is nice,
and I love it.
How you can do the banners.
I love this. So, and it's cool, you know. And then I can put people's, you know, signage and stuff at the mm-hmm. bottom. So, because we got Gemini, we got mm-hmm. single,
yeah,
and break stuff,
yep,
and the Gemini single,
yep. You got it all on there. You got the hashtag, girl. You got it going on.
Okay, members
all down here.
Right? You just came out with an EP. Mm-hmm. Tell us about that.
I came out with Gemini the day before my birthday, June 12th.
Hey!
Gemini's in the house. Woo, woo.
Woo, woo.
It is a 7-song EP. I wrote all the songs myself.
Wow.
I have two producers on there. One is Cordell Walton. He produced Gemini, Me and My Girlfriend, and all the rest of the songs are produced by Justin Credible.
Okay.
And there's some songs on there for everybody. It's a pop soul album. It pretty much balances both of my personalities with me being a Gemini. Mm-hmm. I have a real like funky, funky, high energy side. Then I also have a sexy and a sultry side that I like to bring out too. So.
Right.
Both of those are represented very well in the EP.
Okay. I love Drink.
I like that song too.
It's so smooth. You know, it's like it's like a smooth drink, like for real. I don't even drink that much, but you know.
But when you know,
Drink got me feeling like
up a little song.
I love the music arrangement in it and everything. And it's one of those. Like, I don't, you know, I ain't driving at the moment, but it's one of those put it on in the car and drive situations, you know. Don't drink and drive.
Though. Correct. Don't you dare.
Don't drink and drive, but drive and listen to drink.
Talk about drinking while you're driving.
Right. Drinking what y'all gonna drink when you get to where you're going.
Correct.
Okay. So mm-hmm. where'd that song come from? Where'd the idea for that one come from?
Majority of the time when I hear the music, it always tells me what to write about. So that was the same thing with that song too. I just literally heard the music and that's what it spoke to me. It's like, this song sounds like it should be like a chill song about, cause I do love cocktails. So it fit to have a song about cocktails.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I just like it was, I already wanted to do a song like that. And then when I heard that track, it just, it, everything just came together just like that.
So when you first heard the track, did you immediately like it?
Nope.
Really?
Isn't that crazy? I did not like it. That was the one track that he actually made for me. The other tracks on the EP, he already had, and I chose those.
Okay. Okay.
That was the last one, and he said, let me make you one. I think I can make you one that'll fit you just perfect. And I was like, okay. And every time that I be thinking that what they're going to do, it's never like that. I'd be like, oh, they probably gonna make me something funky. I'm a dancer. It's gonna be like a Janet Jackson type vibe. And
right,
I'm totally different. So I kind of be disappointed at first, but then I just like, I open up to the opportunity of it instead of just shutting it down because it's not what I want. I have a bad problem with that. Like if something ain't the way that I want to shut it down immediately, but okay. I've grown and gotten better at that.
Right.
I opened up and, you know, accepted it and just took it home and just really kept listening to it. And then, yep, it came into fruition of what it was. And now it's one of my favorite songs.
Wow. That's, you know, and I didn't even expect you to say that. I didn't expect that. Cause you know, a lot of time, and I know some artists, a lot of times if they don't like something right away, they don't even try. They just mm-hmm. be like, nope, you know,
yep.
I'm glad it ended up working out because it's a jam. It's a jam. It's unfortunate. On my audio podcast, I will, you know, I play songs or whatever. And what I might do is download some of these and put it on there anyway. Mm-hmm. But it's on YouTube and these different sites playing music. If it's copyrighted material, it don't even matter if the person is sitting right there. It could be your own stuff and you playing mm-hmm. it. Matter of fact, didn't they do that to you?
Did it to me when I did the listening party, when I posted right. music on YouTube, my own stuff. When the EP came out, it was like, oh yeah, this song is cop protected by, I'm like, it's me. Look at the name. Like, pay attention. Y'all just be having people just not even just automatic, just going by the book instead of just actually investigating. Like, and y'all big companies, y'all got enough people to investigate stuff.
And instead of having robots that's just grabbing data.
Thank you.
That's what that is. It's not mm-hmm. even people. Cause it's like, you would think, you know, you look at it, you look at the channel and all this other stuff, but it's crazy. But, and I love music and I used to always play music on my YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. Like if a song came out and I really liked it or whatever, I'd play it and then I'd get a copyright strike. This back in the day, they used to give you strikes.
Mm-hmm.
And those strikes, if you get the three, they will close your whole channel down. And I'm like, so yeah.
I think I heard you talking about that once on your YouTube live.
Yeah. It's crazy. It's like, you know, come on now. I think it gives an artist exposure, you know, like.
I will be the first to always say it makes no sense to me.
Yeah.
I am an artist. Like, I want everybody to hear the music, like spread the word. Like, how else am I supposed to get out here if people aren't listening and sharing?
Right. And it's like, it's not like the, you know, none of the people I've seen when they play other artists' music, they're not claiming it's theirs.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah. Right. Like, why do we even have to put that?
Wow. I do not own the rights.
It's obvious, like, it's obvious that it's not my song.
Right. That's crazy. So tell me about Jay Fears. Where did you grew up in Detroit?
West Side.
I already know this stuff, but still. Anyway.
West Side, Joy Road, Evergreen.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you've always pretty much been in that area?
Pretty much until my house caught on fire in 2006.
Oh,
and
no.
Then we had to move around a little bit, and then we ended up finally being permanent for 10 years, 7 Mile Evergreen.
Okay, okay. Man, a house fire, that's...
Yeah, lost everything, including my poor little cat. And that's it.
Oh!
I was devastated. It was, yeah, I didn't hear.
How old were you when that happened?
What did I say? It was 2007, so let me do my math. 2004 is right. Somewhere around like 24, 25 years old.
Wow, that's crazy. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, my mom was able, I wasn't at home when it happened. My mom was there and she was able to save the dog, but she couldn't save the cat because the cat ran into it. It was scared.
So right, they run and hide and stuff.
Ran to the back of the house. Yeah, mm-hmm. The smoke was too thick and she couldn't get her.
Oh, man.
So sad. My little dear. Yeah.
I would have had a fit on that one.
I know. That's why I say, yo. They are little children.
Wow. Yes, definitely. I know some people be like, oh, my cat.
There's a lot of people that say that.
Yeah. Like, they don't like you neither. No, I just do.
Like, they don't. So the feeling is mutual.
Right. Oh, man. So as far as like your music, you started dancing. Is that what you started with, or did you start with the singing?
Professionally, my first gig was acting.
Okay. Add that to the repertoire.
Yes, to the nice little list. But it's a hard working list now. I'm trying to put it out there like, I'm just out here just getting gigs left and right. There's a lot of hard work and homelessness, skin diseases, all type of stuff that went into this story.
Wow, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah, when I was out in LA, my whole senior year of high school, me and my mom, we did not have an address. I was literally going to school every day from Roach Motels, people letting us spend a night here and there. My whole senior year, I did not have a place.
Wow.
Out in LA, yep. Sacrificing. It was crazy. We were getting ready to sign the lease, and then the person we were supposed to move in with didn't have their half of the security deposit. Mm. And that's just how crucial it is out there. Like, if you are able to get a spot, there are so many people waiting behind you, like the lists are so long out there.
Mm-hmm.
And we missed our deadline and we lost it, and they gave it to the next person just like that. And it's so hard to find a place.
Wow.
That we weren't able to try to find another place that whole year.
Gee, well, if you're it's so crazy, you know, homelessness can happen to anybody at any time for anything, you know what I'm saying? And it's like I hate how people automatically assume somebody's homeless because of, you know, the stereotypical, they on drugs and they drink everything or they gambled all their money away. Mm-hmm. It don't always be that. Mm-hmm. People have become homeless from flukes like what you guys went through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Somebody stole identity. I mean, all types of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I really want to know, like, how did you all get through that year? Obviously, you did, but yes. What?
Yeah, by the grace of God. But we just, I don't, like, my mom just worked. I was in high school, so she kept working the whole time, but we just never had that big lump sum enough again, you know, to try to save up for a place in enough time.
Right.
So, you know, the whole time, my mom always had our place here. My stepdad, she was married to my stepdad at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And we had our house here. So we roughed it out the whole senior year. And when I graduated from high school, I was 18 then. So she let me finish the rest of that summer by myself.
Okay.
She came back home. She was like, bye. You grown now, you know how to drive, you got your license, you know your way around.
Yeah.
I trust you enough, you know, like because I was a very mature 18 by being out there and going through so much and focusing so much on career.
Right.
I really wasn't that much of an idiot. Like, I was a little bit of an idiot because everybody is when they are a teenager, but
yeah.
I did good enough to where she trusted me enough to let me stay out there the rest of that summer. So she had came home back here to Detroit and I had stayed out there, and we had ended up staying in like an extended stay
hotel. Uh-huh.
And that's where I stayed until I came back to Detroit.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
So how did that affect your senior year in high school?
It surprisingly didn't. Like, my mom will tell you to this day, like, she has no idea how I still managed to graduate with honors that year.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't even know how.
That's what's up.
Didn't even have, like,
the grace of God.
Yeah, like, seriously, I really can't remember how I did that. Like, doing homework and like all the kind of city. Like, I remember waking up, like, my alarm clock in the morning in some of the places we stayed at was my mom slamming down killing roaches. Like, that's how I used to. I was like, oh, time for school. That's how she would wake up, and, you know, you turn on the light and, you know, they run.
Right.
She would, you know, yeah, I'd see if she would get up, because she would get up and go to work, and I would get up and go to school. And that's how I would wake up, because my, even to this day right now, if you go around my mama and she sees a fly, she slams flies so hard. Like, she almost breaks windows and stuff, because it's like PTSD or something.
Wow.
So, from, like, just dealing with that, dealing with, like, it would be, like, embarrassing when she would come pick me up from school, and, like, everything that we owned would be in the car.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was just like, you get out of school, and it would be like, okay, but where are we staying tonight? You know, just trying to figure it out. And somehow, through all of that, still did homework, still studied for tests, still somehow managed to get through it.
Wow. Did you have to deal with any, like, ridicule and stuff from the other students?
No, I really didn't. It was a different time.
Okay.
It was a different time. Like, I'm really blessed that I went to school where I did, and the kids there, and that time, it was just nobody really, there was no pressure for nothing. Like, there was no pressure for clothes, hairstyles, none of that stuff. Like, my school was laid back school ever. It was the biggest blessing. Like, there was, like, our prom king the year I graduated,
mm-hmm.
wore blue jean shorts and a blue sweater every day. He wore the same thing every day. He never changed clothes. He wore the same thing, and he was prom king.
Wow.
Blue jean shorts, blue long sleeve sweater from, like, a Kmart or something, and Converse.
See, I wouldn't have got away with none of that at Redford High School or AKA Meyer High.
If I would have stayed at Cody, it would have been the same thing. It's just this is, I mean, we can't help it the way that we're raised in our environment, but that's just that environment.
Yeah.
Like, that was the time when people was wearing pajamas going to school.
Right. Man, because I tell you, these young folks nowadays, I'm very glad that they have uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
At most of the schools, because when I was going to school, even I got bullied about my clothes, because my mother would put me in my cousin's clothes, which was a boy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I remember, to this day, it just bothers me to this day. Like, it's two kids that I went to school with, and I'm like, where are they right now? Are they okay? Because they were harassed and they were bullied so bad by the other kids. Like, and it was one of them situations where, you know, they might want to take their own life. It was that bad. And I just wish I knew if they were doing okay today, you know, because kids are cruel. They're cruel. Adults are cruel too. But anyway, that's another story.
And as we're going along in life, it seems like it's getting worse.
It does.
Are we trying to have, like, hope and be thinking, like, oh, you know, it's really not that bad? Because I don't know, because I'm not in high school, but I can just only, it's like one thing for your to be bullied in a school with, like, a couple hundred kids, but then now they got the internet.
Oh, Lord.
Not only do my high school, but our rival high school know, the high school in the next county know, the high school on the other side of the country, no. Like, it's crazy.
I don't even think about all that connection. I mean, it's bad enough with just your own school, but woo.
It is a lot. You know, a lot of these kids now, the kids are starting to be social media influencers. So they be in in middle school and high school now, 200,000, 300,000, 400,000, 100,000 followers.
Yep.
And you know, just all it takes is one wrong move.
Yep.
That's
what like I gotta call Sammy or Tamika that's in school and ask them to shout me out on YouTube.
Thank you. I know you're doing your homework.
I buy your lunch for a whole week.
I know you're trying to figure out algebra, but that's sad, but it's so true.
Can you just show my link on your Instagram story? Like, man, it's wild now.
It's running different. Especially on that TikTok.
You know what? TikTok get on my nerves. I sit on
TikTok. You love you some TikTok.
I do. My whole Instagram is like TikTok shares.
It is.
But they be cracking me all the way up. They
be very creative. They get very creative.
I be having to drink glue.
They get very creative on there for real.
Man, I'm like, what in the world? And then I post a few things on there and I go back and look and it be like one view.
That's why I don't even mess with that thing. The one thing I did call myself trying to post, I logged out and logged back in a couple weeks. Like, oh, let me see if I got a couple views. Girl, I logged in. They said they blocked my video.
Why?
Because I don't know what I'm doing. I tried to dance to a Drake song, but I guess you have to use the music that they already have in the app.
And I played it
off of like my iPad or something. Girl, they blocked that video. Ain't nobody seen it.
Are you serious?
Okay, yeah, this ain't for me.
See, I didn't know you had to use the sounds on there because I thought like the I don't know. I don't be understanding that stuff.
Yeah, unless I don't know. Like everything that I do, some app is always blocking something.
That's crazy.
So I'm so used to like, oh, TikTok, like, okay, TikTok join the list.
Well, they said that, you know, they said they were blocking Black creators.
I've got like 5 followers on TikTok. I'm not even worth enough to be blocked, so you can try again with that one.
Well, let me make sure I follow you just in case I thought I was, but just in case I'm not, you'll have 6.
Yeah, maybe I'll try to do another video now since I got one more follower. Okay. I have like 5 followers on that thing, and I probably don't even have that many. I probably got like 4.
Oh man, that's crazy.
Yeah, I'm really trying to figure out TikTok, but that's a difficult app.
Yeah, YouTube is a little difficult as well because they have changed things so much.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, back when I first got on YouTube, you could get so many views and monetize your videos. Now there's a requirement that people watch so many hours of your content in order for you to be eligible for monetization. And it's like, what?
Yep, hours and subscribers.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You got to have both.
Yeah. It's just they make it so difficult for people to try to get anywhere unless they already have like some kind of foot in the door with following and stuff like that. So maybe I got to go back to high school. No, won't be doing that.
Oh, no, that's right. No, that's right. I wouldn't step foot.
Right. So tell me about your experience with Uncle Charlie last name Wilson.
Which one though?
Like, how'd you end up going on tour and dancing for him?
I've been working for Charlie. Today is 2020.
Mm-hmm.
15 years this year, even though
15?
15.
Wow.
And I started in 2005.
That is what's up.
And even though we haven't done a show since March because of COVID.
Right.
But they haven't sent me an email and said I'm fired. So I can still send out work for him. they passed those emails out.
Right.
So I got the job from knowing that's one of the very few times in life where you say you just, when people be like, you just got to know somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I knew a girl. I met her from working with Aretha Franklin.
Ah.
And she was like, we all danced with Aretha together. And she was like, I know, she was like, this guy I know, he plays keyboard. And he asked me if I want to dance with this guy named Charlie Wilson. And she was like, and he asked me to grab three of my friends. So you want to dance? I was like, who is it? She was like, some guy named Charlie Wilson. So I was like, okay. I didn't even care who it was. I didn't realize until I told my mom. I was like, mom, I want to start dancing with somebody named Charlie Wilson.
And your mom was like, what?
She flipped out because it was so crazy that the two people that I ended up dancing for in my life were the two people that my grandmother and my mom played their songs on repeat every day. Really? My grandmother used to listen to Aretha Franklin's Everyday People every day, every day, every day. And my mom used to listen to Charlie Wilson's song that he has called Without You.
I love that song.
In the car every day. Every day. No, I don't care. Like my mom is the person, like when she likes something, she wear it out. So I would just
like me.
Yeah, every time that I was just in the car and I was young, I would just sit and look out the window because I'm like, oh my God, here we go with this song again. And they were literally putting that into my life. Ain't that crazy?
Yes, that's wild.
I ended up working for both of them, and those are the two people that stayed on repeat. That's so crazy. I think about it all the time.
That's something though. So what was it like doing that, going around on tour with him?
Charlie?
Yeah.
It is something that I learned because I've been there for 15 years. Mm-hmm. So it's something that I've definitely learned to appreciate as I've gotten older. Because when I was in my 20s, I just loved to dance. I didn't care who I was dancing for. I didn't care the backstory behind nothing. None of that. But like now that I'm older and I'm actually like paying attention, I'm listening to the music that Charlie, I'm listening to his lyrics, I'm listening to where he's singing from. He has a story. You know, I'm relating to him now because he used to be homeless too. And you know, he has his section where he does his gospel section, and he has the dancers come on stage and we'll like play violins and stuff like that. And there's like a whole like praise section. Okay. And that stuff like be literally getting to me. So like there have been times where I be backstage, like I'll just start crying because I can just like relate. And I grew up in church too. So all that stuff is just like, it's in me so hard, like just hearing testimonies and seeing the people in the crowd, like, you know, just, you just never know what people are just going through, you know?
Right.
And you come and you pay your hundreds of something dollars and, you know, you just have, like, you just are thankful. Like, you go to this concert, you don't know what you're going to expect. And then you have this singer who comes out here and he tells his story and you can, like, relate to it, or whether you're happy for him or where you're going through something yourself and you just have a release for a second. I mean, it's just a great experience seeing that. It's a great learning experience, learning the business, learning the good and the bad. It's tiring. It's extremely tiring. It's wearing on your body.
Right.
It really is, from the late nights, the early mornings, the flying, the stress, the no sleep. People just don't realize how much we don't rest. Like you literally rest when you get home. When you're out there, there's no sleep.
Wow. Team, no sleep.
Team, no sleep. And it's not, that's not like bragging. It's just, it's the job. Like, because the team doesn't really care. Like, of course, Charlie gets more rest, but he's the artist. But like, we're the band. So, right. You know, you guys are, y'all gotta be there first.
Y'all just working.
I don't care that you just got off stage at 12 o'clock. You didn't get back to the hotel until 2. You go to bed at 3. You gotta be downstairs at 4 so you can get on your plane at 6. So you can get to your next stop by 8, you get to your hotel, you got to be at sound check at 12. So a lot of times they don't even allow you to check into your hotel because they have to check in. It's not until 3. So you got to wait in the lobby and try to take a nap in a chair, have your luggage and stuff there. And then you don't get a chance to get back into your room until like 12 o'clock again that night. It's a lot. Wow. You didn't get sleep, but you got to go and do sound check full out. Don't get a chance to go back to the hotel in between the shows, in between the sound check and the show, because the hotel is by the airport, which a lot of times is about a 45-minute drive. They don't want to risk it. A lot of big cities have traffic, so they keep you at the venue all day.
Right.
No sleep again. And you got to, well, the girls do, you know, put on makeup, get dressed, and you got to go out there and perform full out and with a smile. Because if you don't, people get on the phone and talk about you and say, well, Charlie was good, but them dancers looked like they had an attitude problem. And I'll be looking at these comments like, if you just only knew for a second how hard it is sometimes to just to put on the, like, we literally be like just drained. Because there are sometimes when, yeah, like sometimes you'll just have a show where it's one show for the weekend, but sometimes there's 4 shows.
Mm.
And you gotta, and there's no break. You do it back to back for 4 nights straight.
Wow.
So it's a lot. It's ups and downs. It's a great experience, but I would not recommend nobody get into it unless it's something that they really love, because it's a lot to the glam, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, because it's like we're sitting over here watching you guys and we just see the actual finishing touches, you know, the final product, and not really. Like, I'm sitting here tripping because I really didn't think about all of that. I mean, I had somewhat of an idea, but at the same time, it's like when you break it down like that, it's like, damn.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and none of that is an exaggeration. Like, it literally, and like the crazy part is, like, it's 10 times worse than that for the crew.
Mm.
Like, at least we, like, when we get done, we get to change clothes. We'll go back. The crew's still there another 2 hours after we get off stage.
And as in crew, you mean the people that set up and break down? Yes.
Because we travel with that, too. It's a A, B, and C party. Charlie, his wife, manager, mm-hmm. stuff like that's A party. Band and dancers is B party. Crew, lights, sound. Stage, you know, your monitor engineer, stuff like that, that's all crew. And those are the people that got to be there even before us. So, like, if we have to be at a venue at 1 p.m. for a 2 p.m., like, sound check is usually like 2 to 4. We have to be there at 1. The crew got to be there like 8 to set up the whole stage. Like, there is no such thing as a stage just being, like, when you just get there, the stage just like all just like rolls in on the truck. Like, every piece of that has to be put together piece by piece. Every speaker, the whole stage, the wardrobe, the little quick set. My light is like trying to fall. Like the quick thing that you see on the side, the whole band, that's a whole breakdown. Each instrument, all of those pieces of those instruments have small pieces that have to get put together. Everything, the lights. When you, after you lift the lights up and put them there, then you got to test them, because you got to make sure that each light has is lined up to hit certain spots where we be dancing and Charlie be going on the stage. Like, all that stuff, it just doesn't happen. Like, it's somebody's job to make sure. And because I'm interested, like, I love all this type of stuff. So right. I'm the one, like, when I come to sound check, I watch, because I be wanting to know how, like, we always just get there. And I'm like, how do all this stuff just get here?
Right.
And I sit there and just literally look. There is a light person that tests, and they have to stand there in each spot where the lights fall. And then the light person in the back, they talk to each other and say, okay, set, move on to the next. And it'll be like 50 lights up there. And they have to go wait for it to line up. Okay, move. Okay, move.
Wow, you making me want to take some CBD oil.
I'm sorry.
Dang, that's a lot. And it's like, you know, You know, and then thinking about, I think I kind of think we had somewhat of this conversation on the audio version about artists showing up late and these crew people setting all this stuff up and them having to be there later than normal. And
yeah, that's the thing we were talking about, people getting fined.
Right.
We were talking about, like, why is it a fine because you show up late?
Yeah.
Noise ordinances, like a lot of those venues be in neighborhoods.
They want you to get done at a certain time.
People got to get rest. People work.
Wow. That all of that is really interesting. Like, seriously.
It's a very interesting, hardworking world. Like, that world, I know for sure, all those people deserve every penny that they get.
Okay, because that's a lot of work.
Mm-hmm. You get away from your family so much.
A long time away from your people.
Don't go on to, like, Charlie is not even an artist like a Bruno Mars, who, like, when Bruno goes on tour, he goes on tour for 2 years straight. Mm-hmm. Like, the little tours that we do, we go on tour for 2-3 months tops.
Really?
Bruno and people like the Chris Browns and the Beyoncés and stuff, like, of course, they'll have like a 2 or 3 week breaks here and there. But yeah, 2 weeks, I mean, 2 years gone, because you have to travel the whole world, Craig.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah, missing families. It's hard for a lot of families to stay together. That's a lot.
Yeah. Wow.
People be thinking like, oh yeah, I want me a musician and da-da-da. Okay.
It is a strain. It's stressful. Mm-hmm. Wow. That's wild. That is really wild. People ask me stuff like, would I want to do traveling stand-up comedy and stuff? And it's like, I don't know. It's never been like a goal for me, like, honestly. That just kind of squiggled its way into my life. But I just, stuff like that makes me be like, wow, I don't know, I'm getting old now. I'm all hobbling around.
Make sure it's something that you want to do.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So what was it like dancing for the late great Aretha Franklin?
You know, dancing for Aretha was complete opposite of Charlie, because Aretha does not fly. So everything,
that's right, she didn't.
Everything with her was bus. And Aretha, like, there, you know, like, okay, so Charlie, like, it's just completely different because Charlie cares about budget, Aretha doesn't.
Okay.
So it's like Aretha is just like, she's earned her right. She's a legend. So she's going to travel like that. So
she want to travel.
Yeah, you know, when she goes to LA, it's not like, okay, well, yeah, we'll travel and find out where we're gonna stay. Like, no, like, it's not, she's so crazy. It's like, we're going to LA. It's gonna take us 4 days to get there because not only do I not fly, but I don't drive at night. So yes, every night we're going to pull over. And no, we're not pulling over in no little side of the road. We're staying at 4-star hotels when we pull over. And no, we're not getting up at 6. When I get up, that's when they'll call you and we'll leave.
She is a true diva.
Like that. Like, it was never like, oh yeah, you be downstairs at 8 a.m. sharp. It was like, okay. You would just get your notification order. They would call the hotel like, okay, yeah. It'll be like 10:30, 11 after she didn't ate breakfast. And
right.
Oh, yeah, Miss Franklin is going to be leaving soon, so you can gather your things. And like, we rail rested by 9, too. We done been down to the gym, 8. Did a little sightseeing. So wow. it was, but the crazy part was that the difference with her was that the diva with her was on stage. So okay. Like with her, like you can say hey to Charlie, joke around with him. With her, it wasn't none of that.
Okay.
Ain't no talking. If you make, you know, if you get too close to her on stage, you getting fined.
Are you serious?
So that's where, like, it was just differences with both of them.
Wow. I wouldn't even imagine. Wow.
Yeah, it was more leisure, but it when it came to on stage, it was pins and needles.
Wow.
For sure.
How was it like? Did you all have a chance to, like, talk with her and different things outside of the stage?
No.
Not really?
The time it was time to talk to her was when she was paying you. Because wow. That was the difference too. Like, you don't, like, Aretha pays you personally. Like, really? Charlie don't do that. Like, you get paid through business, okay, like you're supposed to. But Aretha, every night you wait to get paid by her. And that's every musician. So you can imagine how long that, like, you're spending. We spend our night with the Aretha Franklin camp waiting to get paid. Because don't mess up when it's your time to get paid. Because when you come into her dressing room, she's talking to you about it. And she don't care if it's still 27 people that need to get paid. You about to get paid. You might get some money taken away, and she cussing you out.
Wow. I cannot.
So yeah, we can get done with a concert with Aretha and be standing around at the venue 2-3 hours waiting to get paid.
That is crazy.
Yeah, but you ain't gonna say nothing. You gonna sit there and wait.
You gonna wait for that. You gonna.
It's like, it's literally a pay and an evaluation at the same time.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever get an evaluation you didn't like?
Not only did I get an evaluation, I got fired. I got fired from Aretha for years. Like, there was like a whole decade and some change that I did not dance for her because I wore some Juicy Couture jogging pants. And she didn't appreciate that my butt said Juicy. I got fired for that.
Wow.
Fired for that. She called my hotel room personally and said, "Lose the Juicies." I said, "Yes, ma'am." And that was my last show that day. I didn't even know.
Are you serious?
Yep. And then, yeah, well, it was just so happened that years later, around like 2016 or so, mm-hmm, she happened to call me back. And I had did a couple more shows with her those last 2 years before she had passed.
Wow, she ain't play.
Yep, I did her last show with her at, not the last show that she did in Detroit, but I did the last show with her that she did at Shane Park.
Okay.
I was one of her dancers for that show. The last show that she did was at Detroit Music Weekend.
Okay.
At the music hall. But yeah, her last show at Shane Park, I had did that one.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Rest in peace, Aretha.
To the queen.
Man. Woo.
The one and only.
So what's the favorite place what's your favorite place that you traveled to in your career?
When I was younger, I used to say Florida.
Mm-hmm.
I love going down to this little city outside of what's that, like Fort Lauderdale. It's called I think it's closer to West Palm Beach. It's called Boca Raton.
Okay, I've heard of that.
That was my favorite city. But now that I'm older, my ultimate favorite city that I love to go to is New York City.
Okay. What do you like so much about New York?
It's just the energy that's just there. I love the lights. I love the hustle and bustle of the people. Like, I love that New York makes me walk fast because they will run over me. Like,
damn, play.
Makes you get your stuff together. Like, it's not no, like when you just here in Detroit and you're like, okay, where are we going, y'all? We going, okay, well, how you get? Nah, it's like, you better pull over, figure out your directions. And because when these people, they walking
and they going, they ain't trying to stop and get you
sauce. You better know how to travel on the subway, because even that door closing fast if you don't get off fast enough.
Wow.
You ain't got to miss my exit. Now you got to go to the next one and get off. So it's just, I love that. I love the fashion, that different types of fashion that everybody wears. I love that. What I love most is that everything is just right there.
Okay.
And you can walk to it.
Okay.
That's what I love the most. Like, it's not like, okay, well, I got to go to the cleaners. How far is the cleaners? 2 miles. Like, you know, Target is 8 miles that way. Like, everything is right there. I love that. You can, I can go to, I can walk to Chase literally 2 blocks. I can go, I need to go pick up a little bit of stuff from my hotel room at CVS. That's on the next block. I got to go to the cleaners and wash my stuff for the show tomorrow. That's 3 blocks up. Everything is just like, you don't even have to take a cab. You can, it's just, everything is just walking distance. And I love that. I love that. I love to get out. I don't mind getting out and walking. I love putting on my headphones and I'll be gone when I'll be there.
Yeah.
You told me that I ain't a New Yorker. I fit right in with them. Like, oh yeah, my second home.
Is that somewhere where you would want to live?
If I could afford it, for sure.
Yeah, I know it's expensive.
Woo.
Man.
One of Charlie's dancers, one of my best friends, she lives there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's five girls.
Okay.
And all of us live in a different state. Like, really? I live here. Katie lives in New York. Danielle lives in Atlanta. Jessica lives in L.A. And Tara lives in Sacramento. Everybody stays a little different.
That's fuck wild. Okay.
All five of us are from here.
All right. Okay.
Everybody's from here, but everybody lives, somewhere.
That's awesome. Wow. So tell us about your EP. How's it going? What are your goals for it? Are you working on any new projects?
I'm getting ready to. After I put out the EP, I really didn't get a chance to promote it like I wanted to. Like, I just really had a life. It was, you know, it'd be like you, like, I like, that's why I always say, like, it was like having a baby.
Mm-hmm.
Because I kind of even want to compare it to like postpartum.
Right.
Like, I really had some life-changing things that happened to me after, like, immediately, like, after I did it. And I'm going to actually film a video about it and put it on YouTube and everything, because like, it was just crazy. Like, I just literally just moved all my stuff out the house. I just like took everything out.
Mm-hmm.
I just put everything in the garage. And I've literally been living like that since. And that happened on June 12th and we're here in August now. And like, I've just been going back to the garage and like, I've just been sitting here figuring out like, what do I need?
Yeah.
You know, just like, and I guess I just had that kind of moment. Like, why do I just felt like that stuff has just like been bringing me down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, let me just see day to day, like what I actually need out this garage.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to be, and I just figured it out. Like, I don't really need a lot of it because I really don't go in there for a lot of stuff. So I'm going to do like a really, I'm going to give away a lot of stuff. I'm going to sell my clothes and all that type of stuff. So I said all of that to say that I'm slowly getting into promoting it more like I want to. Like, thank God I did hire the publicist, because if I wouldn't have hired her, I wouldn't have had no kind of promotion for it.
Wow.
But I'm getting into, but it's still doing real good. The getting streams, people are still sharing it.
That's and everything. Good.
So, but yeah, I'm going to be, I even slowed down with my work, with working at the restaurant, so I can get into, because they had, that was another reason too, like between what I was going through at home, I was working so much.
Mm-hmm.
It was like just literally just bringing, it was just like weighing on me, like, God, I am just here so much. I have no time for myself.
Right. And you got to have that.
Yeah. You know, I can't just keep committing my life to this doggone sushi. Like, you have to find somebody else. Like, I love to serve food to people because it does bring people joy. Like, when you sit plates down and people just get so excited to eat, I love that. I know I feel so different.
You have that personality of the type of waitress that everybody is like looking for.
Yeah, even with the mask on these days, like, I still try to give, like, put my best foot forward with my personality and everything, but I can't, it's little, I just been figuring out during quarantine that that's what's been holding me back.
Mm-hmm.
Working so much, because I saw how much I got done when we were in shutdown.
Yes.
I got so much accomplished. I put out a whole, like, I've been trying to put out that EP for like 5 years.
Wow.
And then I put it out in 2 months.
Because I had time to focus. Yeah.
I had time to focus on it. So that really showed me a life lesson that, like, if this is what you want to do, I can't do both, because I'm not young anymore.
Right.
I just don't have the energy or the body. Like I said, like Charlie, that stuff been worn down on me. My knees and back, you get up in the morning, you gotta warm up your body, be moving, stuff like that. So
right.
I have to think about things like that. And I don't want that job to break me down like that.
Yeah.
I want to still be able to work on my goals.
Right. Wow. I just know this, and it's this whole new podcast way that I'm doing it now. All of that has come from having a chance to sit and think.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, how do I want to do this? How do I want to do that? Because it's like, even though my job, I wasn't nearly doing what you do. But I, you know, the storage facility I work at, I barely have help. You know, for a long time I was just the only person there. Then I'm working 6 days in a row, and then it's like when you get to the seventh day, it's like you don't want to do nothing. You don't want to straighten up. You just like, I'm just tired. You know, mm-hmm. And it's like during this time, it's like a catch-22. Mm-hmm. It's like you've had all these unfortunate deaths. Mm-hmm. You've had all these, you know, unfortunate layoffs and these, you know, people losing financial situations and all this crazy stuff happening. But at the same time, you have had, you know, opportunities to think about things, to mm-hmm. sort things out, to figure mm-hmm. out what you need to do here and what you need to do there. And, you know, from that, I appreciate that part of it, you know. But it's like when you're just running, do like you talked about never sleeping and all this, where do you have time to think? Where do you have time to be like, let me put this in order? Because you can't.
Yeah, you'd be too tired. And then that's how stuff just gets backed up and piles on, because when you work in 6 days, 7 days, I can attest to that. I do the same thing when I be at the restaurant. You get one day off. You can't do everything in one day. And even if you try to attempt to, you'd be so tired, you need the one day to rest.
Exactly.
So stuff just, it never gets done. That's why you just got to be like, something got to change.
Yeah, it does. It is, whew. Let's say it again, you know.
It has to change.
It's wild. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I really appreciate you sitting and talking with me again.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate having you back on the show. I love your personality and your style and what you do. Keep doing the damn thing, and let the viewers know, you know, how you would like, if you want them to get in touch with you, if you prefer Instagram, or tell them about your YouTube channel, all of that stuff.
You can, everything with all my social media is all J Fear. So whether, you know, you pick your platform, whatever you like, if you like YouTube, is youtube.com/JFears. Instagram is @JFears. Twitter, I'm trying to do better at being on my Twitter. It's just, that's a whole nother world that I just, yep. Every time I open that thing, I'm just like, I come back. I'm going to try. I'm trying to play double dutch or something with Twitter, because like you just get into that world and they just, as soon as you get in there, like everybody just go,
I've never been able to like really acclimate myself to it.
All the social media sites are all such different worlds.
Yes.
It's crazy. So I'm trying to get better at, because I'll be on Twitter, I'm like, you know, it'll have your thing right there. Like, what do you want to post? I'd be like, I don't know what to say. Like, yeah. How can I figure out like what topic do I want to say? I'll come back. I'll try tomorrow. That's what I literally say. But it's,
the only reason why I post anything on Twitter is because it's connected to Instagram and I just send it to it. Yep. But I don't go on there. Don't nobody reply You know,
right? I got, yeah, the Twitter, the YouTube, SoundCloud.com, mm-hmm. Jay Fears, Snapchat, Jay Fears, all of that. I'm going to be coming now. I have my fan base, or my friends, whatever you want to call it. My supporters are called members only. She has the hashtag down there. Mm-hmm. I'm getting ready to launch my t-shirt and a tank top line with that. That's coming. That's the next thing that I'm working on besides new music and just other little projects that I'm doing here and there, like all my videos and stuff. So be on the lookout for that. If you like my one-stop shop for everything right now, if you want to like buy the songs, listen to the songs, see music videos, everything is at jfears.com. So definitely go to the website. You can purchase and download my EP from there. It's only $4.99. And yeah, we moving forward around here.
That's what's up.
Moving forward, one day at a time.
Well, thank you so much for being on Vibing in the D with Lili.
Thank you.
And like I said, keep doing your thing and don't stop. You know, as long as you're passionate about it, keep doing it. And, you know, things will go your way. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it'll be slow, sometimes it's not, you know, but keep doing you. And, you know.
Thank you for you too.
Yeah, thank you. All right, hold on a moment, okay?
Okay.
All right.
It was so great to have your eyes watching. To advertise here, please send inquiries to info@experience.com.
With Lili.